See, guilt is a good thing. Guilt is like pain. None of us like pain, but actually pain is a wonderful thing. It lets us know that something is wrong. If you have your Bible, I'm going to read to you one verse from Exodus chapter 20. This is the chapter in which God gave the law to Moses on Mount Sinai. We have not been looking at them one by one. I'm looking more generally at them and trying to understand some of the undergirding issues and principles. But verse 13 is the sixth commandment. It's just four words. You shall not murder. Man once consulted his doctor. Doctor, he said, I've been misbehaving and my conscience is troubling me. The doctor said, and you want something from me that'll strengthen your willpower? And the man said, no, doctor, I want something that'll weaken my conscience. You know, conscience is a very wonderful thing. We're going to talk about this a little bit later this morning. It's a siren in the soul. As Paul indicates in the book of Romans, it's the voice of God to us. Now we can damage our conscience, we can distort our conscience. But our conscience is a gift from God to enable us to stay on track. And when Moses came on the mountain with these 10 commandments on the tablets of stone in his hand. I wonder how he himself felt about the laws that he was bringing to deliver to the people of Israel. I wonder if any of these laws had deeply penetrated his own conscience. No doubt, like all of us, he struggled with most of them. You will have no other gods before me. It's so easy to be sidetracked from God, even to good things that are to do with God, but they become substitutes for God. Like the man I heard about who put an advertisement in a Lonely Hearts column. He said, young lady with sports car wanted. Please send photo of sports car. You can get caught up with things that may come from God, and they become substitutes for God. You shall not steal. How often, and covet your neighbor's property. How often we would like something that is not ours because we've never learned to be content with what we have and what we are. You are not commit adultery. Moses was a faithful husband and the father of several children, but he knew the battle with sexual temptation that all men know. You're not bear false witness. You know, once we're broken almost one of these other laws, this one becomes easy to break because we then need to cover our tracks. If you steal, you can be absolutely sure a thief is a liar. If you commit adultery, you can be absolutely sure you'll tell lies. You shall not covet. Well, Moses had given up all the pleasures of Egypt to serve God in a difficult situation. Maybe this was not one that Moses struggled with very much because he'd faced that and he'd won the battle in that area. But there is one commandment here which would have stung deeply into Moses' soul. You shall not murder. You see, Moses had been a murderer. Murder is the worst of all crimes. In most countries, the heaviest sentences are reserved for murder. Moses might have argued it was out of self-defense, at least if not for himself, for his people, because one day he'd seen an Egyptian beating a Hebrew slave, and so he had intervened and killed the Egyptian and buried him quickly in the sand. We know Moses' conscience was alive at that moment because it tells us he looked this way and he looked that way, and in seeing no man, he attacked him and killed him. But Moses made a big mistake. He looked this way and he looked that way, but he did not look that way. He did not look up. And the torment of his conscience before God would have followed him for all the years since then. Moses had to flee from Egypt, wanted for murder. And here, as God gives him the law written with his own finger, he writes as a sixth commandment, you shall not murder. In chapter 21, Moses then begins to explain the details, the amplification of how this works out in the law courts of Israel. And in verse 12, the very first issue he addresses, after he addresses the releasing of slaves after 7 years, he says in 21 verse 12, he writes this down, anyone who strikes a man and kills him shall be put to death. And as Moses wrote those words from God, I don't know how his conscience was seared by that. Moses himself deserving of the death sentence. And let me tell you why I'm pointing this out to you. It's for this reason that Moses did not come down the mountain wagging a big finger at the people who are waiting for him in the valley. Moses came down the mountain as guilty as the people who are waiting for him, and as guilty, may I say it, as you, and as guilty as me. We cannot look at these commandments dispassionately or merely objectively from some kind of distance, because as we do so with honesty and integrity, they strike right home to our own hearts. They expose us and they condemn us. All of us. Moses had his sin exposed and he stood guilty there before God. And so it is for you and for me. Now, when I say and read the words, "you shall not murder," it's very likely that most of us breathe a sigh of relief and say, "Phew, that's not one of my issues." Although in the last 2 years, there has been a gentleman who has sat here week by week and gone home and in a fit of rage did murder his wife. He's awaiting trial. I'm in correspondence with him. But most of us are not guilty in that sense. But you know, the scripture broadens its definition quite considerably. In 1 John 3 and verse 15, John writes this: anyone who hates his brother is a murderer. You see, scripture is always concerned with cause rather than simply with effect. If murder is the effect, hatred is the cause. And says John, writing to Christians there, he says, if you hate your brother, you are a murderer. Jesus brought it to an even more uncomfortable level when he said in the Sermon on the Mount, you've heard it was said, you shall not murder. But I say unto you, anyone who is angry with his brother is subject to judgment. And you and I can become angry with one another. And there said Jesus, you stand under the same judgment as the murderer. Because anger there is the seed of murder. The book of Proverbs tells us we can destroy people with our tongues. He says in Proverbs 18 verse 21, the tongue has the power of life and death, and those who love it will eat its fruit. You see, you and I might never have the courage to put a knife into somebody's back, but with our tongues we can seek to destroy their reputation. We can undermine their integrity. We can seek to destroy them. And we could go through the rest of this list that God gave to Moses. And it's about you and it's about me. Now we're all different in the areas in which we are vulnerable and weak. There'll be some here this morning and stealing is a battle in your life. The cause of that, by the way, is you've never learned to be content with what you have. And that's a crucial thing in life. And it's an ingredient in the Christian life. The Lord is my shepherd, said David, I shall not want. In other words, I have everything I need. I'm complete in that. Sexual sin, which is listed twice in the Ten Commandments. He talks about adultery, which is sexual relationships outside of marriage. He talks about coveting your neighbor's wife. That's about lusting. Your neighbor's wife may never know. It's the secret lusting of your own heart. Maybe that's an area in which you struggle. Bearing false witness, lying, deceit, which I mentioned just now, is the natural product of all the other sins, really, because we cover our tracks. We could go through the list, and we're not going to now, other than mentioning those few, because the point I want to make is that none of us are left standing on a moral high ground. We stand together as Moses did, under the judgment of the law that God gave to us. And I said just now that Moses did not come down the mountain wagging his finger at the people. And may I say this, there's little more nauseating to the world at large than when the church wags its finger at the world, which we're very prone to do when our own house is in such a mess. The backbiting, the gossip, the destruction of others is rampant in the Church of Jesus Christ sometimes. I know I've seen it. And probably most despicable when it's behind people's backs. That's not an attempt to correct somebody. It's not motivated by love. It's not trying to help them. It's an attempt to destroy them. And it's evil. And yet it's prevalent. We talk about marriage and the sanctity of marriage, and we'll talk about that also in a week or two's time. But you know, when divorce becomes epidemic in the church. We've lost all moral authority to address the world in these issues. Now, I know there are reasons why marriages dissolve. Scripture acknowledges that. When it simply becomes that the church follows the world so quickly. Then we've lost credibility. But I want you to observe something very important here. There are 28 chapters in the five books of Moses that talk about the moral law, the Ten Commandments, and then its outworking. 11 chapters in the book of Exodus and 17 chapters in the book of Deuteronomy. That's 28 chapters altogether. And as Moses received that law, and as he thought of himself and his own life, and he thought of the people that he'd left at the base of the mountain to whom he was going back, it was as though every new law was God closing in until at the end of it, it was a case of checkmate, Moses. This exposes, this judges, and this condemns you. And it exposes and judges and condemns us too. 28 chapters of it, but there are 39 chapters in the books of Moses that are devoted to showing how a guilty person can be reconciled to a holy God, how he and she may be forgiven of their guilt and made right again. 39 chapters, and they talk about a tabernacle that God told Moses to build, and then a priesthood that were to stand as representatives of people before God, and then of blood sacrifices which would make atonement for the people. Six of those chapters are in the book of Exodus, 27 in the book of Leviticus, and six of them in the book of Deuteronomy. And all these were about the purpose of mediating between guilty people and a holy God. God said to Moses, build a tabernacle, which is really a tent, according to the plan I give you. If we translate it into our own measurements, approximately 15 meters long and 5 meters wide. It was divided into two sections. The first section, 10 meters by 5 meters, was called the holy place. And then behind that, at the back of the tabernacle, was a 5 meter by 5 meter room that was called the Holy of Holies. And when God told Moses to build that, he said, there I will meet with you. The priest alone could access the Holy of Holies, and only with blood, which was symbolic of the atonement that enables men and women to be reconciled to God. Then outside the tent in the courtyard, which was around this tent, which was built, by the way, initially at the base of Mount Sinai, there was an altar in which the sacrifice of animals could be made. And then God said, ordain a priesthood, and they set apart one particular tribe and family, the family of Aaron and the tribe of Levi, and they were the ones who would stand on behalf of the people to represent them before God. One day I'd like to take you through the book of Leviticus. It'll take more than a day, of course. The book of Leviticus is not an easy book to read, but I think it more clearly portrays God's provision for human guilt and need than any other book in the Bible, when you understand it in the light of Christ, because it foreshadows Christ and gives detail that we don't understand in the New Testament until we go back to read it in the book of Leviticus. You see, there were five offerings that they were to make. The first was a guilt offering. At least, I'm putting it in this order. There was a guilt offering. And that meant if you met a man who was coming to the tabernacle with a lamb in his hands and you say, excuse me, where are you going? I'm going to offer a guilt offering. What's the issue? Well, I've committed sins and I need to be forgiven, and I'm going to take this lamb as my substitute, and they'd bring it to the priest. And then a few days later, you might meet the same man coming also to the tabernacle carrying another animal, and you say, have you committed the same sins again? He said, well, no, I haven't, but it's another issue. This is for a sin offering. You see, my guilt offering was what I did, but I realized that what I did is a result of what I am. What I am is the problem. I have a corrupt nature. And the sin offering was identifying yourself, not just your sins. By the way, don't make that distinction between the sinner and sins. It's the sinner who's guilty. It's his sins who are the symptom of his guilt. There's remedy for sins. There's remedy for sin, the nature behind it. And then you meet this man a few days later, and he's coming with another animal. You say, what are you doing this time? He said, well, I'm going to offer a fellowship offering. What's that about? Because I realize it's not just my sins, what I did, that is the problem, or myself, but having dealt with that, I need to be reconciled to God. And the fellowship offering is about enjoying fellowship with God, communion with God, intimacy with God. We don't come out of our sin to be left in a vacuum. It's to be brought into fellowship and relationship. And then you meet this man a few days later. He's bringing this time not an animal, but he's bringing some food. And you say, what do you got there? He said, well, this is a grain offering. You see, I've got some bread here. It's made without yeast. Yeast is a picture of sin in the Old Testament, and bread was to be without yeast, unleavened, in other words. And it's been mixed with oil. Oil is a symbol of the Holy Spirit in Scripture. And you see, it's not just that my sins have been forgiven and myself, my old nature's dealt with, but it's also that I'm reconciled to God in fellowship with Him, but I need to know what it is to live a holy life. That there's no yeast, and the Holy Spirit, the oil, mingles through every part. Then you meet him a few days later, and he's coming with another animal. You say, what are you doing this time? He said, this time I'm coming to offer a burnt offering. You see, the whole of this animal will be burnt up till nothing is left. This is symbolic of the fact that I present my body without reserve as a living sacrifice, that from now on, God has exclusive right to use me. I have died to myself, and this animal represents me. That's, in a nutshell, the gospel in Leviticus. And it is the whole gospel, from our sins to our sanctification. And all of these were revealed on Mount Sinai, because God did not give the law in order to condemn the Israelites. He gave the law in order to expose their need, to diagnose their condition, that He might lead them to a remedy. But a proper diagnosis is necessary to a proper remedy. You ask any doctor that, you get the diagnosis wrong and you'll get the remedy wrong. Get the diagnosis right and you can get the remedy right. And that's why the law gives the diagnosis of our own hearts. Now we know that the Sinai law was provisional and partial. It foreshadowed Christ. But you know, when God gave this moral law to Moses, He did so on the mountain in the context of great drama and fear for the people. You see, the people were to keep right away from the mountain, from the foot of Mount Sinai. And Moses went up to meet with God. And as the people looked up to the mountain, there was thunder, first of all, then there was lightning, then a dense cloud descended, and then the mountain was covered in smoke, and then it billowed like a furnace, almost the picture of a volcano. Then it says, God descended in raging fire to the accompaniment of a very loud trumpet blast, and the whole mountain trembled violently, it says, and all the Israelites, standing at a distance, trembled in fear. And then God spoke out of the fire, you shall have no other gods before me, etc. You see, it revealed the sovereignty of God. It revealed the holiness of God. It created the fear of God. And you know, we have to see God in His sovereignty and His holiness. Until we are awed by God, until we're overwhelmed by God, until we fear God, we'll never really know God. But you know, the way back to God was not to climb the mountain through the thunder and the lightning and the volcanic images of fire. The way back to God was to take an innocent lamb, go to the priest in the tabernacle, and allow the blood of the lamb to be a symbol of what one day would be the true currency that would remove sin, the blood of Christ. But the blood of the Lamb would foreshadow that. You see, God was not giving the law to the people that they might have a checklist they could compare themselves with and get up in the morning and say, no other gods before me. Yeah, I'm pretty good at that one. No graven image. No, no images around my place. Not take the names Lord in vain. No, I don't do that. Don't steal. No, not for a long time. And you go through the list and check it off. You know, some of you use the law that way. Jesus talked about a man who went to the synagogue one day. He used the law that way. He was a Pharisee. He got up to pray and he prayed, I thank you, Father. I thank you, God. I'm not like other men. Then he went through the list, Jesus tells us. I do not steal, he said. I do not commit adultery. I am not an evildoer. I fast twice a week. I tithe my money. And as he stood there going through his checklist, telling God, God, I thank you, I'm the man I am. I thank you, I'm not like a lot of other men. He looked across the synagogue and there was a tax collector. The worst of the worst, the tax collectors, you see, were accountable to the Romans for the money they were able to produce for the Romans, but they were not accountable to the people for the money that they took from them. And they took a huge margin for themselves. They were traitors to Judaism by even serving the Roman government. You know, the New Testament gives a special category for tax collectors. It talks about there were sinners and tax collectors. Sinners is not a good enough word for them. It's too good a word for them. And sitting across on the other side of the synagogue was a tax collector. And this Pharisee knew all about him. And he said to God, God, I thank you, especially I'm not like this man. That man didn't have his checklist. And if he had, he would have failed on every point. He couldn't say, I do not steal. He probably couldn't say, I do not commit adultery. You see, once you've violated the basic integrity that the law requires, you're open and go through any door that's available to you. And if a woman threw herself at his feet, he would go for it. You can be sure of that. He couldn't say, I'm not an evildoer. He couldn't say, I fast twice a week. Man, he ate everything he could get. He didn't say, I tithe my money. No, he robbed people of their money. But what he did was smite his breast and say, God, be merciful to me. And Jesus said, which of these two men went home justified? I have nothing, he was saying, absolutely nothing to offer a Pharisee who ticks off his checklist. I have absolutely nothing to offer him at all, but I have everything to offer the man who cries out, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Yes, we need to know the law of God because that exposes our guilt. As I mentioned last week, it's like a plumb line that a builder might hold against a crooked wall, and it won't correct the wall, but it'll expose the crookedness of the wall. That's what he did for Moses. Now, the word guilt has become a bad word in our vocabulary. The idea of guilt is regarded as psychologically damaging. A well-known psychologist, Albert Ellis, has written a paper. It's entitled, There is No Place for the Concept of Sin in Psychotherapy. Whatever you do, don't make somebody feel guilty. Freud, who of course was the father of psychotherapy, saw guilt as a result of what he called the superego. The superego was the influence, usually in young life, of parents and society around us, which gives us our orders, then judges us and threatens us. And it's the superego over the ego, which is our true self. That is, it's the superimposed ego, it's artificial, over the real me, which creates the sense of guilt. And Freud said, there is no moral law, only moral conditioning. And we have to free ourselves from that. Now, Freud says there are things that are good and bad and right and wrong. But you've been programmed that way. Now there is such a thing as false guilt. And I'll tell you, the devil is the peddler of false guilt. He's called in the book of Revelation the accuser of the brethren. That's because one of his works is to accuse and to condemn. There is a false guilt that we need to be liberated from, but there's a true guilt that comes from the violation of the law of God. Part of the Holy Spirit's ministry is to convict the world of guilt. See, guilt is a good thing. Guilt is like pain. None of us like pain, but actually pain is a wonderful thing. It lets us know that something is wrong. I thank God for toothache. It means I know there's decay in my tooth and I need to get it fixed. I thank God that one day I experienced pain across my chest such as I've never experienced before, and I discovered I was having a heart attack. I thank God for pain. It lets me know something's wrong. Guilt is like pain. Dr. Paul Brandt has written a book called The Gift of Pain. Paul Brandt was a missionary in India working in a leprosy hospital. Leprosy, as you probably know, destroys the nerve endings. The people can no longer feel. And so lepers will stub their toes and not realize they've done any damage, or they'll burn their fingers, or they'll mutilate their body unwittingly. It's like if you go to the dentist and your face is frozen, and before the anesthetic is worn off, you try to eat something, you end up chewing your cheek or your lip because you've no pain. And one of the things that Dr. Paul Brandt says is that if there's one gift he would give his patients, it is the gift of pain. May I say this, that perhaps one of the gifts that we need from the Holy Spirit of God for some of us is the gift of guilt, true guilt, and awareness of guilt. Because we have distorted our consciences, and you can destroy your sensitivity to guilt. You can lose your conscience. Paul wrote to Timothy, and he speaks to Timothy about holding on to faith and a good conscience. And he tells us why. He says, some have rejected these and have shipwrecked their faith. That's why I said at the beginning, one of the biggest impediments to spiritual growth is often a lack of true repentance on the part of those of us who are Christians. We can shipwreck our faith by not holding a good conscience. We can tame our conscience. You see, every time you sin, your conscience will respond. But if you sin in an area in your life, the first time you sin, your conscience will scream at you, and you may lie awake at night unable to sleep because of your conscience. But if you do it a second time, the scream will not be as loud. You do it a third time and you'll sleep okay that night. You do it a fourth time, you'll begin to say to yourself, hey, a bus didn't mount the pavement and flatten me. Maybe God doesn't mind after all. And you'll start to kid yourself, it's okay. I've talked to people, you know, who've been involved in adulterous relationships, and they've all rationalized it as being okay between them and God. These are Christians. I think everyone I've talked to in that setting has justified it. And they've violated their conscience. We need to know God's law and his judgment, but we also need to know God's mercy and his forgiveness. We need to know there is a way back. We need to know that as fire on Mount Sinai was the context in which the law was delivered, that in the tabernacle with a lamb, there's a way of forgiveness and cleansing. You know, sometimes I fear that knowing the possibility of forgiveness has the effect in our minds of devaluing the seriousness of sin. Because we say to ourselves, well, I can always be forgiven for this. As somebody said to me one day, he said, if God forgives our sin, isn't it as though he's given us a blank check and you can do whatever sin you like as long as you say sorry at the end of it? And that is our understanding of forgiveness and sin. What we have done is turn the cross, pardon the expression, into a doormat on which to wipe our dirty feet. We go out and get messed up, come back in, just wipe it off and say, okay, forgive me, I'm okay now. Now, forgiveness is available, but there has to be repentance. And repentance means not just I'm sorry for what I did, but it's saying I'm changing my mind about what I do. And repentance doesn't just affect yesterday. Repentance will affect tomorrow. It's a change of mind. Anybody will say, I'm sorry when they're found out. My kids are brilliant at that. You can say sorry when you find out. That isn't necessarily repentance. Repentance is seen in what happens tomorrow. Not what you've done about yesterday's guilt. I want to go back as I conclude to that verse we began with, you shall not murder. I'm going to talk next time about the sanctity of human life and a much fuller explanation of why human life is sacred. But of course, murder is the biggest undermining of the sanctity of human life. And as I finish, I want to talk about some issues that come very, very close to the bone and very close to our society. Abortion is an obvious one. Now, let me say, this is a very sensitive issue. Emotions run high over this issue, and I'm not in a position to address it physiologically nor psychologically. I can only address it or attempt to do so theologically. What bearing does Scripture give us on our understanding of this? Also, I recognize I'm handicapped in talking about abortion simply by the fact I'm a man and I'm not a woman. And we men need to listen to women on this. There is substance to the statement, it's her body. And as a man, my view is more objective. But I do know that in Canada, right now, more than 2,000 abortions are taking place every week. The fact it's legal means nothing. You can legalize any sin you like. And I want to just very briefly deal with this sensitively. It is a complex issue. But I know from Scripture, the unborn child is very precious to God. Psalm 139 makes that very clear when the psalmist says to God, you created my inmost being, you knit me together in my mother's womb. In my mother's womb, you knew me, you were at work. My frame was not hidden from you, he goes on to say, when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. The unformed body, says David, was precious to you. I know there'll be people here this morning sitting in this congregation, and those of you listening on television, and you have been through the trauma of an abortion, the panic of an unwanted pregnancy may have driven you to a course of action that you have probably regretted ever since. And maybe you've told almost no one. As I understand it, the majority of women live with the consequences of this for the rest of their lives. They know the guilt and the pain. And they remember the day every year. They remember the likely birth date of the child. They wonder who he would be or she would be now. And they find a place to go away and be alone and weep. Because there's deep sadness. It's not like having your tonsils out. It is a human life. But you can bring it to the cross. And men were involved in this process. There may be men here this morning too, and you have been the father of an aborted fetus, and you're not untouched by this tragedy. Nor is your guilt untouched by this tragedy. But you can know forgiveness. We recognize the seriousness of the law of God and the sacredness and sanctity of human life, and we cannot diminish that nor compromise that, but we know there is forgiveness. You see, Moses has ended a life. He was a murderer. God said of Moses, he's the most humble man in all the earth. God speaks to Moses as a man speaks to a friend, it says. God entrusted to Moses, you see, your guilt can be forgiven. And you can be redeemed. Maybe it's the hatred that 1 John speaks about when he says anyone who hates his brother is a murderer. This does bring this down to an uncomfortable level. Is there someone you hate this morning? You say, well, I don't actually hate them, but you'd like to see them destroyed over something. It's true. Jesus said, he who is angry with his brother is subject to judgment. Maybe it's destructive words. The tongue has the power of life and death. And you wouldn't have the courage to put a knife in somebody's back, as I said earlier. But your words are angry. Your words are vicious. Your words are destructive. Your words are vindictive. And you need to repent. It is the seeds of murder. I'm going to ask you to deal with these issues this morning. If God has spoken to you and you know there is unresolved guilt in your life and you've never been liberated from it, you may say, well, I've confessed it 100 times, but you've never accepted that you're forgiven and cleansed and justified. I'm going to do something that some of the liturgical churches do. Many liturgical churches have a point in the service where the minister pronounces the forgiveness of those who are truly repentant before God. I'm going to use a prayer from the Anglican Prayer Book that I'm adapting slightly. I'm going to take the liberty of declaring to you that you are forgiven. You are clean. Now, I know there's some complex repercussions to our sin, because this is so often the blockage to spiritual growth that maybe we long for in our own hearts, and we wonder why we keep spinning our wheels. It's a lack of true repentance, and conversely, the acceptance of full forgiveness. Total forgiveness. And a man like Moses, who killed a man and buried him in the sand, can be a prince with God. That's the invitation to you. My concern in looking at these commandments is not just we go home saying, yeah, that was fine, yeah, that was interesting, that we go home changed, released, forgiven, empowered. And I ask you, as God is speaking to you, and I'm speaking to you as a Christian, let's clear that blockage this morning. Let's pray together. Lord, I pray for each man and woman here this morning. Lord, I thank you that you do love us, that there is a cross that stands at the center of history that invites us to come and confess our sin, with the certainty that the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin and we can be forgiven and renewed. Lord, I pray that many might know a burden roll from their backs
Many may know that they're clean this morning. And we'll go home aware of the seriousness of sin because we're aware of the holiness of God, but also aware of the cleansing that's been extended to us. Help us to walk home free of the burden of our guilt. I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Do you know someone who would benefit from this message? Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca. And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message and follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel. Tune in next week for the continuation in this series from Charles Price. Michelle was a dedicated student at university. Her parents were hard-working immigrants to Canada. They believed a good education was the key to a better future. Michelle dreamed of becoming a teacher. She was also in love and planned to marry her high school sweetheart.
Audrey and I were dating. We had a committed relationship for a very long time.
I was dating Michelle for years. I walked Michelle home. We were together like every day. Every day from sunup to sundown, we're together.
Then Michelle received news that changed their lives forever.
I found out that I was pregnant. This came as a shock to me. I was frightened of the result. I shared it with Andre. We both were kind of panicking on what to do, what our future would look like.
Michelle was terrified to tell her family. She would ruin both her dreams and theirs if she did not get her degree.
My fears were amplified by my parents' fears, seeing their disappointment, seeing their own fears come through, wondering how I was going to finish school. I quickly turned my decision to having an abortion just because of the hurt it was causing everybody. Just needed to do something about the situation, and I thought abortion was a quick fix.
At first, Andre agreed, but later changed his mind.
When I thought about it, I said, Michelle's different to me. Like, I love Michelle, and this, having my child, I want her to have my child. It only makes sense.
But Michelle was confused and trapped, closed in by a web of pressure. She went through with the abortion.
Leading up to the procedure, you're just denying the whole procedure of what's actually happening, but very emotional. Emotional outbursts. Really, your emotions are everywhere.
Michelle later graduated from university. She and Andre continued their relationship. They married. The abortion had seemed like a solution, but it wasn't.
It took over 4 years before I actually even looked at what took place and that I actually had an abortion. So in 2000, when I had my son, all the memories of my abortion came back to me. Guilt, shame, not being there for that child.
The emotional pain became unbearable, so Michelle decided to seek post-abortion counseling.
I'm so glad you came.
She found what she needed through a Christian organization, the Pregnancy Care Center.
Just the fact that knowing that God saw me in my time of distress too, that he was there for me, even when I didn't know that he was there for me, and just like, hey.
Through the Bible study, I was able to look at the various emotions that I had after an abortion: denial, anger, shame, guilt, and looking at forgiveness as well, and how God views you after an abortion. So I was able to feel forgiven and know that I was forgiven and be able to get that healing that I needed.
The Pregnancy Care Center has provided practical, emotional, and spiritual support to over 4,000 women like Michelle over the past 25 years. The center offers post-abortion support, pregnancy tests, prenatal classes, and counseling. It is a nonprofit Christian community that cares for women who find themselves alone and vulnerable.
Well, as Christians, we don't want any woman to feel that she has to abort her baby just because no one cares, because no one is around to help. And we would like every woman to know that life is precious and that there are Christians that care enough to walk along beside her and to help her through this whole process.
Abortion's promoted in our society as the only option, but that young women have options that they can parent, adopt, and have that emotional support that they need through a difficult time for an unexpected pregnancy.
Did you ever feel like that?
Prenatal classes teach the young women how to care for babies. But just as important is the nurturing they receive themselves.
My mom, she put all the eggs inside, like a taco.
Taco!
We feel that the greatest gift that we can have to offer them is the hope of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, and being able to let them know that in Christ they have a big family.
Today, Michelle and Andre have been married for 10 years. They have 4 children.
God has always been faithful from day one. Just the fact that we had an abortion to having 4 beautiful children, they're my heart's desire. I live and die for my children, you know? I'm the proudest father ever.
I gave my life to Christ because He is truth. So He will reveal truth in our past so we can heal from it.
Michelle's painful past has prepared her for a new role. She now speaks to young people about her story and helps to train pastors and youth workers about these issues. She shares her no-holds-barred experience of abortion and talks about sexual integrity.
And we cannot stay silent about the consequences of sex outside of marriage. Abortion is not a quick fix, adds more problems, and again, a human life is gone, you know?
I think Christian workers and leaders need to be equipped through things like first response training, so that we know more the intricacies of what it's like to go through an unexpected pregnancy, to be able to empathize and be able to provide some assistance and some solutions.
Michelle's journey began with heartbreaking loss, but now God is using her and the Pregnancy Care Center to bring young women a message of hope.
The Pregnancy Care Center completely turned my life around. God has been there the whole journey, from the abortion all the way to today. He's richly blessed me where, you know, something that was meant for evil could turn to good, to bring Him glory.
And all our praises, and all our worship, and all our from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host.
Son, praise the Son,
and praise the Holy Ghost.
Oh.